God. Yeah. Hey. 9-on-1, Shelby Drive, look alive, look alive. Came up on this side, now they on the other side. Oh well, them dog, we gon' see how hard they ride. I get rested.
Welcome back, everyone. I am your lead writer and host, Christian Fowler. And joining me, as always, is Go Tigers 247 founder, Brooks Hansen.
Cheers. Thanks for having me back.
This was a huge weekend for Memphis basketball as Penny Hardaway and staff reeled in four-star forward from Olive Branch High School, DJ Jeffries. And Brooks, we've talked about DJ Jeffries and his recruitment on the last two episodes. So what are your biggest takeaway from his commitment?
Well, I mean, going into the fall, we didn't really have an idea of how much of a closer Penny Hardaway was in terms of recruiting. Obviously, everybody expected him to be a fantastic recruiter because of his pedigree, because of what he's done in his career and how he recruited at the AAU level. But now I think you can surefire say Penny Hardaway knows how to go into an in-home visit and seal a deal. He's a closer. Penny, on Monday morning, he woke up and had a big cup of coffee because coffee is for closers. So that's number one. Number two, DJ Jeffries gives Memphis something at the forward spot, the kind of two through four that Memphis really has not had. He is super skilled. One of the things that I've said about DJ Jeffries over the last year, seeing him about, five, six times over the last year, is that DJ does everything in such a way that it's so effortless that you almost, it looks like he's not trying or it looks like he's not really doing much. But then you look up and he's got a massive box score. So Memphis is getting one heck of a player in DJ Jeffries. I do know that the Kentucky staff loved DJ Jeffries. Those around that staff raved about him. And you can sell it all you want that they got Khalil Whitney and didn't want DJ Jeffries, but I personally know firsthand from information coming from the Kentucky staff that they loved what Jeffries brought to that potential roster in Lexington. So those are my two big takeaways. What about you?
So for those of you who don't know, I'm from Olive Branch, graduated from Lewis Burke High School, so I've been able to watch DJ firsthand for a few years now, and I've really seen him grow. I started watching him, I believe, his sophomore year when he was a top five recruit. And like you said, he's a guy that can play the two through the four. And that's rare for a guy coming out of high school to be that versatile at 6'8", 6'9". But he can handle the ball, and he can also get down low and bump. And honestly, in my opinion, that's one of his most effective areas is when he's down low, he's able to work on the boards and show off his athleticism, because there's not a lot of bigs that can hang with somebody that's 6'9" and as athletic as a guard. So for Penny Hardaway to close the deal on a guy like that that can come in and be an immediate impact guy.
Yes.
And then you also have Malcolm Dandridge, who I don't think is getting enough credit for being a big two that they're bringing in. So they're bringing in these two guys right now. You're starting to see his class come together and what he wants to do in the front court and overall on the floor. We know how versatile that Penny wants to play on the floor. We talked about it a little bit last week with how versatile he wants the front court to be. And you're seeing that. You're seeing him put together his plan, and that's starting with Malcolm and DJ. So, Brooks, like I said, we talked about the recruitment. We talked a lot about Mississippi State and Memphis and who it was going to be. So how did this one unfold?
Well, I mean, this has been controversy for the last week. And I honestly, I'm done with it. I'm so over the back and forth between people that want to challenge the idea that there was any fluctuation in this recruitment. But I do think that it's kind of funny that today, Tuesday, when we're recording this, that another recruitment that should have been a common sense, slam dunk, 100% type of recruitment, where, if you follow logic and you think about it logically, that, it should have been a done deal. So today, Jeremiah Robinson Earl, a top 20 prospect, five-star kid from Kansas. He's down at IMG Academy. His family, his entire family went to Kansas. Bill Self, their entire staff has recruited JRE for years now. And you would think he committed today to Kansas. But guess what? Logic and what you think is going to be a automatic, almost a given in a recruitment, didn't happen today. And that's because we're dealing, in talking about recruitments, we're dealing with 16, 17, 18-year-old kids. Logic doesn't play a part of these discussions, period. So if you want to tell me that it was always going to be Memphis, that's fine. That's revisionist history. And any kind of argument that you're presenting is just full of opinions. It's all opinion. I think that's my opinion. That's fine. You know, when I do my crystal ball, I do it based upon fact that's coming from staffs involved in a recruitment or from people around a kid that's being said out of the media so that you know it's true. It's not meant to maybe shift momentum. It's not meant for leverage. It's just straight up fact. So my crystal ball last Sunday was Mississippi State, and DJ Jeffries said himself it was going to be Mississippi State when my crystal ball said Mississippi State. My crystal ball at the end, when he chose Memphis, said Memphis. So I don't know how anybody could look at that and say that somehow I was off on the way that I covered that recruitment. So with that said, I'm slamming the gavel down. I'm done. I'm over it. So cut.
So Brooks, now that we see Penny's class coming together with the two pieces now, we're kind of seeing other guys starting to drop. You see James Wiseman saying he's going to announce on the 14th. And then you have Boogie Ellis telling 247 Sports basketball recruiting analyst Evan Daniels that he's going to announce his commitment on the 9th. And that was on Monday. And then on Tuesday, Boogie came out and dropped his top five, which consisted of Memphis, Duke, North Carolina, San Diego State, and USC. So Brooks, with Boogie's recruitment, we've heard from same guy Evan Daniels that Duke and Memphis are looking like the two biggest players right now. How are you seeing that shake out over the next couple weeks?
Yeah, so, well, first I would say, Christian, don't sell us short. We actually had that Duke and Memphis duo battling it out for Boogie Ellis about 3 weeks ago, right after the Memphis Madness visit. So, you know, I would say give yourself some credit, give Go Tigers 247 some credit there. But, you know, overall, San Diego State is the hometown team. Yet again, another situation where logic might dictate a recruitment, but it's not. The bottom line is Boogie is probably going to leave the West Coast, and that's just calling it like it is. Right now, Duke and Memphis are right there at the top. Duke has a bare cupboard in terms of guards, and right now they've got a lot of guys that they're trying to close out. Vernon Carey, Isaiah Stewart, and some other guys that they're like really, really trying to hang in there and get. But right now, UNC's recruiting class, Duke's recruiting class, Duke's is not top-notch like you're used to seeing. And that's why I think Duke kind of holds the edge over Memphis. They really have a ton of playing time. But I think the bottom line for Memphis and why they're in there so deep is the relationship that this staff has built with not only Boogie Ellis, but the people around Boogie Ellis from the very beginning of Memphis's recruitment. This staff built a tremendous, deep relationship and really got to the core of who Boogie Ellis is. If you look at some of his comments, his social media, he's a unique cat. Like, he's just different. He's a West Coast kid. But Mike Miller has some of that swag to complement what Boogie Ellis brings in terms of personality. So I think this Memphis staff has put itself in a position to potentially steal Boogie Ellis away. Do I think it's going to happen? I don't know. I think they'll be in there until the end. Duke's hard to beat, though. And when Coach K comes in that living room with all those rings and what he's done with Team USA, sometimes it's just not going to happen no matter what you sell. So, what do you see happening over the next few weeks?
I think his recruitment definitely hasn't been as windy and as curvy as some of the ones that we've seen. But for a long time, we heard Arizona was out in front. And then you see in his top five today that they're not even listed. And Memphis was a team that didn't offer him until August 12th. So going back to what you said with the relationship that he's built with the staff, and we spoke with him when he dropped his top eight August 14th, right after he got the Memphis offer, and Memphis was included. And when we talked to him, he raved about the staff. He raved about all the NBA experience on the staff, and particularly Mike Miller. And when we talked to his head coach, Marshawn Cherry, he kind of said the same thing about the NBA experience on the staff and how a staff like that can develop you. So you got to give Memphis credit here for coming in late. And I know Duke also offered late, but for Memphis to get involved with a West Coast kid that's looking at Arizona and Oregon and all these other schools out on the West Coast, for them to get involved and become one of two major factors in his recruitment is a testimony to this staff. Even if Boogie's not a guy that they get, you can just see how hard the staff works and how good they are at building relationships and what they're doing on the recruiting trail. So overall, it is impressive for Memphis to get in here. We're not, like you said, we're not going to be surprised if it's Duke. It's hard not to go to Duke with Coach K there and everything that he's done. So it'll be a fun one to watch come out over the next couple weeks, and we know the type of player Boogie is. So it'll be fun for sure.
Well, one thing I would say to compliment what you just added was it shows that this staff can identify guys that they know they have an opportunity with. So you see a guy like Boogie Ellis, he's West Coast. You think USC, Arizona, San Diego State, Gonzaga was originally in there. Some of those teams you think, oh, well, Boogie Ellis, surely he's going to go there. But Memphis was able to identify pretty early that they thought they had a shot, and they went all in on him. His recruitment has been pretty quiet. He's done his thing. He's taken his visits, done, you know, not a ton of media fanfare around him. Now he's a big social media guy, but you know, he's just doing his thing. And Memphis just stuck in there as teams fell off. And here's why. You look at you know, a team like USC. USC has the number one recruiting class in the country. They recently took a commitment from 6'3 shooting guard Kyle Sturdivant out of Georgia. They stole a guy from the Southeast to come all the way out to California and play for them, and they took him over Boogie Ellis. So, you know, you look at Arizona, Nico Mannion, he reclassified, moved up to the 2019 class, and, you know, the dynamic of their recruiting class, pretty much once they sealed the deal there, they were out for Boogie Ellis, and Memphis just consistently kept their head down, went to work, and put themselves right in the running for him. So I'll be interested to see what happens next Friday, because I don't think Memphis is getting enough credit, but I think that they've got a puncher's chance next Friday. So we'll see.
Memphis will play their second exhibition game against Christian Brothers Friday night, 7:00 at the FedEx Forum. Last Thursday night, they played Lemoyne Owen. They got 120-66 victory. Freshman guard Tyler Harris had 26 points. And our local basketball guru, Brooks Hansen, had some bold predictions that went vastly awry. Brooks, how does it feel to be that wrong last week?
Man, so I completely f***ed up. Totally. You can edit that, Kenny, right? So please edit that. So I totally screwed the pooch with my predictions for last week's game. And honestly, one of my big fears is that we hype things up so much in the preseason. And I just want to, like, for myself and everybody else that pays attention to what I write and what I say, to just temper expectations. And so going in the last week, I thought for sure Tony Sarwar, you know, former coach, he knows Tyler Harris. He knows what he does well. He knows what he doesn't. I gave him way too much credit. And I did not give Tyler Harris enough. So, you know, I'm really, you know, what it really did for me was, like, it made me just sit back and say, I got to stop trying to pigeonhole Tyler Harris into what he is and what he isn't and what he's going to do at the college level, how his game's going to translate from high school to, you know, now the D1 level, and just watch him, like, let it play out and take it week by week, analyze what he's done, and then, you know, try to, like, predict from actually seeing him against Division I competition. So, you know, that said, Lemoyne Owen, D2, let's wait and see what he does against LSU maybe and some of their really good guards before we jump to too many conclusions. But, man, I was totally wrong. I said Memphis wouldn't shoot well, and Memphis shot extremely well. How many threes did they hit? 13? I think they hit more threes than the number of times I said crystal ball on last week's show. So, and that's pretty impressive. So I would say that I totally missed on what would happen last week. So I tell you what, this week I'm going to put you on the spot. I'm going to ask you what you think about the exhibition game this week. So what do you think Memphis is going to do against CBU this week?
I mean, I feel like we saw a lot last week from the freshmen, and that's something that we pointed to multiple times, that we wanted to see what the freshmen were going to do. And by the way, Brooks, we made it 9 full episodes with no curse words, but the 10th. I guess it's something about the 10th anniversary. But the freshmen really stood out and impressed me. Tyler Harris was obviously the leader there with 26 points, but across the board, the freshmen played very well. And I think against a team like Christian Brothers, so you're going from a more athletic team in Lemoyne Owen, but a much better coach team, in my opinion, against Christian Brothers. They're going to sit down, they're going to play defense, they're going to be disciplined, and they're going to know, you know, your tendencies. So it'll be interesting to see how those guys fare, kind of like you said, Tyler Harris, what he does later in the season. Well, this will be another opportunity for Tyler Harris to show us what he's made of. And I think Memphis comes away with another easy win. I don't think we see them winning by, you know, 54 like they did last week against Lemoyne Owen. I still think they'll be impressive. I'm going to be looking for a different starting lineup. Not that this starting lineup didn't play well, but I think Penny wants to throw as many lineups out there before the regular season starts on November 6th. So wouldn't be surprised if we see a different starting lineup, some different combinations. But overall, I think we see another, you know, a fast pace. They move very fast. I was very impressed by that. And like you said, the shooting, they shot 43% from behind the arc, which is something this team hasn't done in a long time. And it was also the first time the Memphis Tigers basketball team has put up 100 points since last year's exhibition game against Lemoyne Owen. So I'm looking for another 100-point game, another 35-plus win, and more impressive stats from these freshmen.
Well, I will add, this is not a prediction. This is me saying I'm looking forward, for the sake of the fans, seeing David Wingett on the floor. You know, last week he was in concussion protocol and didn't get a chance to actually play in his first game on the FedEx floor, Forum floor. So for me personally, I think that's one thing I'm going to look forward to is actually getting a chance to see David Wingett play. You know, I love being able to actually go out and watch some of the guys that Memphis, other teams recruit and eventually end up signing, and seeing them ahead of time so that I actually have perspective to give. With David Wingett, never seen him, not going to try to say what he is and what he isn't. So I'm really excited just to see him on the floor and see what he's going to bring to this team. So that said, I don't think I said anything that you can hold me accountable to next week. So I'm done. Anything you want? Any bold predictions from you? If not, we can move on.
Yeah, I mean, you try to you get me at the end of every episode. So I had to come back with something this week, and that's my first shot. That's all I'm going to say.
It's only fair. It's only fair. All right, Christian, it's my turn to play MC. I'm taking over the mic, and I'm going to throw something to you. This week, Memphis had a new football commitment from 2-star wide receiver from Germantown High School, 6'2", 175-pound Cameron Baker. According to Germantown High School coaches, a dynamic playmaker that is really going to outperform his rankings for Memphis. So what is Mike Norvell and Memphis getting from Germantown High School and Cameron Baker?
So like you said, Brooks, Cameron Baker is first off a big-bodied receiver, but he's somebody that's very skilled. And I spoke with his high school coach, Chris Smith, who's, like I said, the head coach at Germantown High School last night, and he told me Smith played at UCA with Norvell. Smith was a freshman, Norvell was a senior. And he said he's taken a lot of his offense from what Norvell does at Memphis. He tries to make his offense pretty similar and his terminology pretty similar to what Norvell and the Memphis offense does. So I think first off, you get a player that's polished. So he's going to come in, he's gonna know your system, he's going to be a crisp route runner, which is something that's hard for a freshman to come in and do, is excel at route running. But that's something you see with these lower ranked guys. To stand out, they have to, you know, they have to work hard, they have to run routes, they have to do all the little intricate details that some of these higher ranked guys don't necessarily have to focus on in high school. So he's definitely going to be polished, big body receiver. Coach Smith said that out of all the receivers that he's seen in his 4 years at Germantown High School, that Baker is the best at going up and catching it in traffic. And Baker is also a guy that has shown up on the brightest of stages, which I think that's what you want in a receiver. Receiver is supposed to be a playmaker. They're supposed to step up on these big stages. For example, last Friday night, they're squaring off against Whitehaven, who's, you know, one of the top teams in the city. They end up with a 37-19 win, and in front of the Memphis coaching staff, or in front of Coach Norvell and running backs Coach Anthony Jones, Cameron Baker has 9 catches, 151 yards, and a touchdown. And for some people, that may seem like an anomaly, but that's something that Baker's been doing all season. He has over 70 catches and over 1,000 yards already. And Germantown High School is actually undefeated this year, so he hasn't made it through the first half in most games because they've been up by so much. So he's a guy that with if he comes in, gets some good coaching, develops his body a little bit more, develops speed a little bit more, which is something that he said he's been working on for a few months now, and something that he'll definitely be focusing on going into his freshman season. He's somebody to watch out for. Maybe not his freshman year. He may be a guy that they want a redshirt, but he's definitely somebody to watch out for in the future. And he's drawn comparisons by his coaching staff to Anthony Miller. You know, not a high-ranked guy, but he's going to come in, he's going to work his butt off, and he's going to pay attention to the little details. So they're obviously getting somebody that wants to work hard and wants to be in Memphis.
Well, I think for anyone out there that watches this Memphis team, what Mike Norvell puts on the field in terms of an offensive product, you know that skilled guys like Baker, that's what drives this Memphis offense. So guys who can go out and make plays when the spotlight is shining, that's what makes this team really tick. And speaking of that, we actually have a game to cover this week. And I know for you, Christian, that's very, very good news. You love covering Memphis football. You love covering just football in general. So got a big week ahead. So take it away. What do you think we're going to see this week with Memphis football finally returning back to the field after a bye week and having a chance to redeem themselves after that just miserable game in Missouri?
Well, like you said, I'm definitely happy to get back to football. Love covering basketball, but happy to see Memphis football back this week. And I think coming off the bye, Coach Norvell is obviously a great game planner. He obviously sees the nuances of a defense and goes in and attacks those. So with 2 weeks to prepare for a defense, I would expect this offense to come out pretty hot. And Darrell Henderson will be back this week. The running game was still pretty good, over 180 yards against Missouri a couple weeks ago. But it lacked the explosion that they have with Henderson. Yeah. You don't get the same 40 and 50 yard plays without Henderson on the field. So for him to be back, to have 2 weeks of rest and to get some guys healthy is definitely a big thing for this team. They get to come in against a hungry East Carolina team that'll be starting a freshman quarterback. I know Memphis has rolled over East Carolina in the past couple years, but this isn't the same team. And I don't just say that because Memphis is playing them this week. Last season, they allowed over 250 rushing yards a game. Well, they're down to 250 this year, and they're allowing 215 yards per game in passing. So this defense is much improved. And also, to me, the biggest thing that I will be looking for this week is, can Memphis finally get it done on the road? They're 4-4 this year. They're 3-1 at home, and they're 0-3 on the road, actually. So this will be their first chance to get a road win. They've got a long trip to Carolina, but I think you'll see them come out this week and finally get over the hump on the road. It's something that needs to be done. They had a rough game against Navy, Tulane, and Missouri on the road. So this is their opportunity to come back and show that, you know, we may not be, you know, may not be 10-2 or 10-1 like we were at the end of last year, but we have this opportunity to come out and close out these last four conference regular season games and get to a bowl game and continue building with this recruiting class that they're bringing in. So this is the beginning of that. Obviously, coming off the bye week, they get a fresh start going into East Carolina.
Personally, for me, what I'm looking forward to this week is seeing a hopefully healthy Darrell Henderson back on the field for Memphis. I don't think this got enough attention. The UCF game, you see Darrell Henderson get hit with the helmet in the thigh, was not the same player in the second half. And then the following week at Missouri, he talked about how pregame he felt his hamstring tighten up, and then obviously completely ineffective in that game. So didn't play the majority. And with that, you see Darrell Henderson dropping down in terms of total yards in the country. He's now number two. So I honestly just want to see Darrell Henderson back on the field doing what he does and making the game so exciting to watch for Memphis fans. So personally, that's just, you know, I'm not going to call a score. I just want to see Darrell Henderson, period. So that's about it for me.
Now, Brooks, time to get into our Q&A segment. So first up is Tiger Chaz. Tigers have commitments from Dandridge and Jeffries. Assume we will get Wiseman around November 14th signing date. Do you see Penny and staff having one or two more commitments by the end of November signing period, or a total of five with Watford still pending in spring?
Well, first, I'll take the most obvious thing. Yes, I believe that Trendon Watford will still be pending in the spring of 2019. I think he is totally going to wait, play things out. You know, the only way that that somehow ends early is if Alabama just comes in and just wiles him and gets him to sign early. So that's, you can just stop asking about that. Trendon Watford is going the distance. Originally, I think there was some discussion about Watford deciding early. Not going to happen. I could totally see Memphis having four guys out of the early signing period. And I'll just leave it at that. I do think that that's possible. Do I think it's the most likely scenario? No. I mean, I might put it at like 40% that they end with four. All right. So with that said, last question. Just so happens to be a football question, and that's your specialty, Christian. Who is Mike Norvell still going after in the 2019 class? Are we still recruiting Christian Williams, defensive tackle from Southwind? Seems like we can get some good pieces to help bolster the defense with the 2019 class. That's from Chris 2121.
So the first part I'm going to take in that question is about Christian Williams, the Southwind high three-star defensive tackle. Yes, Memphis is still actively recruiting him. He's somebody that has pretty much from the beginning of his recruitment said he was going to wait it out. He wanted to play his senior year at Southwind first. There's obviously a lot of SEC schools involved, but he has a great relationship with the Memphis staff, and in particular, defensive line coach Paul Randolph. So Memphis is still heavily involved there and one of the top players in Christian Williams' recruitment. And as far as some other guys that Memphis is, you know, after now and they have a good chance with, first up would be Louisiana running back Charvis Thornton. He's somebody that named Memphis as his leader last week. I know Memphis has Rodriguez Clark and Jared Snoop Connor already committed in the 2019 class as running backs, but it's always a good thing to keep piling up these guys. Memphis loves to use their running backs, obviously, as you can see on the field, and Charvis is one of the most talented in this class. So he's somebody they're after. And then you've got two Texas defensive end and outside linebacker, Braylon Garcia and Javasia Brunson, who both are high on Memphis right now. They've actually picked up a couple crystal balls for Memphis. So those are a couple defensive guys. And then the last one there pretty much is Donald Clay, who's an SMU commit right now. He's high on Memphis. He's still debating on whether to take an official visit to Memphis or not. He's in his senior year right now, so he's waiting that out at John Curtis High School in Louisiana. So he's not somebody that's going to come out and say that he's going to take an official visit just yet, but he's definitely contemplating on it and thinking about it. And in my opinion, Memphis will have a good shot to flip him from SMU. So then they've also got a couple SEC guys that they're still after pretty hard, you know, some of those lower-ranked SEC guys that they're going to keep building relationships with and keep going after regardless of if they're committed somewhere else. So obviously no balls have dropped there yet, and that won't happen until National Signing Day or until after the early signing period. But those are definitely things that we'll keep an eye on, and as soon as we hear something, you guys will obviously be the first people to know there. So that'll do it for this week's episode. Finally got some Memphis football back in there, got some Memphis recruiting in there. But Brooks has put me on the spot the last 2 weeks with these questions at the end of the episode. So I've got to get back at Brooks this week.
Oh, I'm still doing it.
Brooks is definitely still going to come at me, so I'm going to come first. Brooks, I'm going to flip your question that you asked last week around to you. So me as your protege, if you could change one thing, what would it be?
Man, I'll be honest. Like, you have been very, very good so far. You know, with being, 5 months in, I'd say that you've done a heck of a job. But, you know, you are, and this is not a knock, You are a heavy football guy, and it's hard transitioning somebody like you from football to being basketball minded, to being basketball recruiting minded. So, you know, just teaching you to see through a lens that Memphis fans see through, that's been a little bit of a challenge, but it's nothing that, you know, is completely new. So I'm not saying that that's not a deal breaker. You're still my boo. But no, seriously.
Yeah, okay, go ahead and lay one on.
Yeah,
me.
It's coming. Let's do it. All right, so I'm gonna tell you one thing that I've noticed you say way too often.
I already know.
What is it?
Obviously.
Man, it was so obvious that it was obviously. So, you know, now that I've said yours, I want you to tell me one thing that I say way too much, whether it be here on the show or when we're on the phone.
The thing that you say the most, I think we've heard legit a lot tonight. That's a one-off, okay. Though. That's not something that's every time. Crystal ball, you love that word. I think everybody found that out last week, as I think you said it 10 times.
That's just a sign of the times. Everybody's talking about crystal ball predictions. It is what it is.
Okay.
Give me something real, though.
Okay, something real. Yeah, definitely. Brooks's favorite word is yo.
Yo.
Yo. Every
my
time.
My voicemail, if you call me, my voicemail starts with yo.
It's exactly what I was about to say.
Because I want to mess with you people.
Every time you call Brooks and you don't get him, yo, then you start to talk and you hear, this is my voicemail, every single time. So yo is Brooks's favorite word for sure.
Yeah. One thing my wife makes fun of me about is saying the bottom line. I say that way too much. So I'm giving you one. So in closing, though, there was a request last week. I had a good number of people actually ask me what I was drinking. So this week I am closing the show with my choice of spirits this week, and it's Michter's Small Batch Unblended American Whiskey. Got some notes of vanilla, some toffee, some caramel. It's delicious. Got a little spice to it, not too much. It's been really good to me, this show. So next week I think I'm gonna go with my Weller Antique 107. So you guys
spoiler
stay tuned
alert.
For that. Yeah, Weller. Shout out to Cheers in Collierville. They always have some of the best selection of whiskeys and bourbons that I can get my hands on. Every time I'm out there, I stop in, and this is not a sponsored spot. I appreciate Cheers.
He's jockeying for free shipments right now. That's what's going on here.
I'm not gonna complain if they do. So, but that said, Christian, thanks again. It's been a lot of fun. This has been a fun episode, and I think just the tenor around both programs right now, despite the two losses in a row. For football, I think the tenor is really upbeat. There's a lot of good things going on, and you know, honestly, I can feel it in the conversations with you and with fans on the message board. So really exciting times. So thanks again for having me.
Absolutely. Thanks, Brooks, and thanks for everybody else. That's 10 episodes now. It's not the biggest milestone, but thanks to everybody behind the cameras, behind the scenes. You guys don't get to see how hard these guys work to make this happen.
Shout out to Kenny.
Yeah, shout out to Kenny, shout out to Riley, shout out to our old co-host Trey Draper.
Yes,
so,
sir.
Thanks for everybody that's gotten us to this point. It's only 10 episodes, but we've got a lot more to bring you guys.
Yeah. 9-on-1, Shelby Drive.